Commons, which in association with the LATC is helping produce the Encuentro 2014, specifically all of the kind of tertulia events that are happening around the Encuentro. We're hosting 9 events during the month. This is the very first one, and it's gonna be moderated by the lovely Jerry Quickly. He's gonna introduce himself shortly. But I just wanted to give a few ground rules. We are live streaming back here, so if you have questions, please speak up. I'm trying to get another mic in here, but worst case scenario, let's all speak up. There are also at least one other show still going on upstairs, so people are gonna be filtering in. That's totally fine, or that's when their show gets out. People may filter out because they need to get to another show. That's the beauty of working with a festival that has 10 shows a day. So we're all just gonna be very understanding and forgiving of that, okay?
Okay.
Cool. All right, in addition to this space, we also, the Latino Theater Commons, in association with HowlRound, the LATC, and the Latino Theater Alliance of Los Angeles, has kind of cleaned out and is starting to archive things in the vault, which is if you go up these stairs and towards the bathroom, you can see it after this tertulia panel. And that's kind of the place where we're holding and housing all of our treasures, all of our kind of collected works. Dr. Tiffany Ana Lopez, and Dr. Jorge Huerta, and Dr. Chantal Rodriguez are the kind of curators of that space, and I encourage you to check it out after this panel. All right, without further ado, I give you Jerry Quickly.
I thought we might best facilitate this by giving you some context for the folks on stage. Very briefly, I'm a writer and a performer. I've had solo shows produced by Red Cat and The Taper, and they toured around. I've taught at several universities, working on a project at The Taper now, funded by the Irvine Foundation, creating dialogue between communities, Community Alert Park and Montebello. And I'm writing an opera currently with Philip Glass. We just presented the first movement a couple weeks ago. So that's what I'm doing. Now, our artists and performers here are all incredibly accomplished, and 3 of them have solo shows in the festival. So I'm hoping they will tag on something about their solo show at the end of their self-introduction. So,
Ruben. Hi, my name is Ruben Gonzalez, and I'm here with the Teatro Campesino as part of the Encuentro 2014. Solo shows called La Esquinita USA.
Hello, I'm Karen Anzuategui. I'm a solo performer.
I'm really verbose at this.
This is still on. So, I am an Ecuadorian extraterrestrial, categorized as a permanent resident alien, so I'm really an alien agent from Her Majesty's Secret Salsa Service with a license to transport subversive performance art across state lines and international waters. Some jokes I do just for me. And I'm performing here, I'm grateful to be here, performing aliens, immigrants, and other evildoers, a sci-fi Latino noir solo performance. Looking at the persecution, the current persecution of Latino immigrants, satirizing the idea of the immigrant as an extraterrestrial, and looking at the humanizing, dehumanizing moniker of the illegal alien, and at the same time, looking at that legacy of demonization within the United States of the immigrant other through a sci-fi prism informed by film shorts and many of the personas and characters I play are actually inspired by interviews of people I did who shared with me their border crossing stories. The piece was commissioned by Gala Hispanic Theater at the National Performance Network, the Ashe Cultural Arts Center, and the Mecca Community Center. So it's based on, it's also inspired by really beautiful moving stories of people who crossed the border.
And in the Milky Way, it's Jose Torres.
I didn't mention it.
My name is Juan Enrique Carrillo. I like to say I was made in Mexico, but born and raised in East Los Angeles. That makes sense to me. I hope it does to you. And so I'm a founding member of East LA Rep, a creative space here in East Los Angeles. I've acted for many years, but in the last 2 years, I've done a little switch over to solo work and writing. So I think that's why I'm here. And I also teach elementary school in Los Angeles.
Hi, I'm Marisa Chivas. Oh, let me pick this up. We're gonna be like all crooked. I'm with the CalArts Center for New Performance, Duende CalArts, and my show is called Daughter of a Cuban Revolutionary. I'm going to be part of the festival the last 2 weeks.
Let us start with you. I really think that, and maybe I'm completely full of shit here, but I think that a large number of solo shows, for whatever reason, seem to tend to be focused either aesthetically or emotionally on moving towards something or moving away from something and the feelings associated with that movement. Whatever that is, whether it's a Donald playing somewhere or whether it's a war that you never were a part of and wanted to be a part of, or whether it's a parent. But it's about distance and space and how we relate to it emotionally. At least that's what I think when I see solo theater that really resonates. Is that context of the conversation that's created, the emotional conversation about spatial relationships and time and distance, does that play out in your work?
Yeah, it does. And interestingly enough, I was thinking about this a lot as I haven't done the show in 3 years. I've done it in 5 cities, 3 countries, 2 languages. And when I started the piece, it was very much excavating and claiming my family's stories and history. Both my parents were alive when I started the process, and now they're both gone. And actually, fairly recently, my mom. So the daughter part is very different now. I'm not a daughter of anyone on this earth right now. And as I come back to the piece, I've just felt this those spaces really shifting for me in a big way. And I'm also not claiming that history anymore. I've claimed it. So there's another kind of opportunity, it feels, doing this piece now, and especially as part of this festival. I just got emotional. It's so meaningful to me. When I got the phone call from Chantal that I was gonna be with this group, I said, you have no idea what this means to me. So it's toured for 7 years, and to bring it back home and to share this completely new place of claiming this history or revisiting this history to audiences who have not heard the story is really exciting to me.
Karen, can you talk a little bit about the relationship, or if there is a relationship between the space of the writer or the characters and the things that they're talking about and imagining. Like, because it almost seems like it's like a north-south kind of whole thing that either completely attract, completely repel, and very often powerful solo pieces illustrate that effectively.
Well, thank you. I'm very honored to be here. I feel that definitely I like to juxtapose the different scenarios that my characters are living through, based on autobiographical experiences that I've had. Because I like to play with space and time as well, I tend to want to see how the opposite could possibly be versus what's actually happening or what happened, playing with the imaginary and kind of like weaving it through. So I think that definitely there's polarities. I like to see how the characters swim, how I could do different things with them, depending on where I put them. Mm-hmm. So throughout the 8 years that I was working on the show, and I'm working on the show, I discover new things all the time. It's very telling my experience, very like profound way sometimes of like self-discovery that I never thought I would be able to like experience like in solo work, but throughout playing with the characters and putting them in one country, putting them in the other country, whether it's in Argentina, whether it's in Paraguay, whether it's in LA or Moreno Valley, just seeing how that stretching, what that does to the characters, what that does to me, has been inexplicable in ways as an actor, as a writer, but as much as I'm limited in expressing myself with words through my solo performance, you know, and experiencing through my body, I think it's the best thing. It's really great. I don't know if I answered the question.
Well, let me ask you, I think particularly on solo work that features.
Something like two questions, like a little short question.
When you have characters in a piece that some are closer to what is being discussed or felt or talked about, and some are maybe further away, I don't want to talk too much on this, but the space between those characters, I imagine, or their relationship to the event is well defined. And why do you pick different characters speaking about the same topic from a slightly different angle? What is revealed by creating that from multiple characters?
Wow.
Sorry.
No, you know, it's interesting because I mean, everybody's process is different, right? And to me, I'm slightly crazy, right? As we all are, I'm sure. And so I don't sit and say I'm going to write a show, you know. I just allow them to come to me because sometimes it's in a physically embody them. Their physicality comes to me, and the voice comes to me, and they'll say whatever they need to say. And because I write in flurries as opposed to every day, so I just allow them to speak to me. And like there's a character in my show, and I've had this discussion with other people. Sunshine, you know, she said something else when I first embodied her and her voice came from me. But it wasn't the right thing to say for this particular piece. But the character was right. And so I had to revisit her, and I just sat in front of the theater, the Teatro Campesino where I live, and I said she's gonna come to me. So I just sat there as her with a pen, you know, and then just one thing happened to me, and the monologue just came to life. And I find that when I'm writing characters that come later on in the process, they find their space in the show. You know, it's crazy the way things come to me, but I have a lot of voices in my head. They tend to come at the time when I'm writing this thing, and they create their own space. And they're emotionally, they might be in a different place. There's one character that drives a solo show. Well, at least for mine, I don't tell stories about my life. These stories just come to me, and so that one character that we're following, the other characters around them, they usually find a way to break that. That lead character's perspective open, and that creates either space from what he's learning or she's learning, or from what she needs to learn. So I don't know if that answers the question, but it's an emotional space that I think you're talking about or you're asking about.
So the characters kind of inform each other emotionally.
Yeah,
so
or they inform that they inform the lead that they're circling. From those perspectives that Lee finds either their redemption or their forgiveness or whatever it is that they're looking for.
Jose, let me ask you, why are you a theater artist? And what is there unique about being a solo performer that attracts you to that area of the theater? Why do you do this with your life?
I've got nothing better to do. I'm trying to channel some voices. It's funny. So I come from the visual arts and creative writing.
So I'm very interested in creating, like very many performance artists from the older schools. My mentors are Guillermo Gomez Peña, Rodessa Jones, Tim Miller, happen to be some interesting California brilliant performance artists. I feel like the performance artists can sometimes use a personal story and be an intrepid practitioner to use the personal to explore some universal ideas. But coming from, inspired by the work of people like Guillermo and others, and even Karen Finley was a visual artist, right? And when I first saw Karen Finley, she gave me permission to rant and rage, because I love the way that she just threw it all out there and actually, you know, accosted the patriarchy that it costs women in general in this country. So, you know, for me, performance has to be very visual, as much as it's driven by poetic text. Because I also come from a spoken word, the New York Weekend Poets Cafe when I was in New York. You know, because I was born in Ecuador, I was raised in New York, and I make my home in New Orleans. And New Orleans is my muse. That's where I became a performance artist. I started putting visual arts together, literature together, and street theater. For many years, to support my bad habit of making esoteric performance art, it was very political. I juggled fire on the streets of New Orleans, and I did Comedia del Arte. And I, you know, toured and performed as a comedy juggler and Comedia del Arte all over Europe as well. So, and I studied pantomime. So all these things come together. And the driving force, above all, is how the personal story is really much more universal. So in the program, it said that the theater artist is alone on stage. We're never alone. It's always collective. I mean, you know, this piece, Aliens, Immigrants, and Other Evildoers, because of the funding from the NPN. I've got John Grimsley, who does my entire lighting design, who's the brilliant lighting designer I work with in New Orleans on numerous pieces. And I could say to John, here's the script, John, I want sci-fi Latino noir. And John's like, yeah, sure, you know. And he comes back, and he's like, boom, and it's there. And then my video artist, my musically, Billy Atwell was there. It was really beautiful, because Billy Atwell and I have been collaborating for 20 years. He does all the soundscapes and original music. And then there's Claudia Copeland, the classical vocalist, and we have the sci-fi videos. The video Vato that I use, his name is Bruce France. So it's all collective, you know, and even, you know, we have Amir, we have the text. It's never alone, and I think that for me is also that collective ritual, right? Because you may be, I consider maybe the performance artist can be a catalyst for some possibilities. Does that?
It does. Let me ask you, very often, solo performers, the work I've seen, I know personally, not always, but they often operate from a space of perceived kind of responsibility, either storytelling or people in their past, maybe people that were, you know, older than them, elders in a generation, or young people they grew up around. How much does your relationship with the community that you come from, how much does that weigh into the work that you create as an artist, and what are some of the ways that it finds its way in if it does?
Can you repeat the question?
How, your work, where do you live? How much of an impact does that have?
I'm just kidding. Well, I mean, for me, this is a new thing, you know, the writing thing, and I think, I started writing about a year and a half ago. I took a master class with Luis Alfaro, who I love, and he's become a mentor, and he's brilliant, and I love his style and his work. But one thing he said, I remember he said this very clearly, he said, write the story that needs you the most, right? Write the story that needs you the most, and I thought that was, because remember, when we all got there in this class, there was several of us, we all wanted to write the sexy story, we all wanted to write the funny story, we all wanted to write the dramatic story, right? But he said, keep digging, and find the story that needs you. And going back to the community, I mean, I think when you're new to writing, I think that's very natural to kind of write from where you come from. That is, I think that initial burst of writing, very often, I've noticed in other writers, seems to be like that story of your neighborhood, that story of where you come from, that story of community. The same thing happened to me in my first piece, Sueños y Frosted Flakes. It ended up being about, it was for my dad, but it ended up being about me teaching in East LA. But also what that means, right? What that means to be in East LA, to have your foot in East Los Angeles, but your other foot in Mexico, right? And how those two worlds kind of collide and combine and collaborate and mess you up, but also make you kind of cool and make you different. And so you know what I mean? So in that case, that show was all about the community I was from, you know, and just kind of owning it, you know, and saying, you know, not making it precious, not making it, because, you know, it isn't in a way, it's just who you are, you know, so you're not anything special in a way, like everyone is special, you know what I mean, but it's who you are. But I think for a new person, at least from my perspective, I think that first burst of writing, it does tend to be that, completely you're who you are, where you come from, like you're kind of exploring that thing in a way.
So let me ask you, you've done a lot of work in traditional theater, you know, legit television and stage and film. And you've also done extensive work as a soloist. What is different about that reservoir of working as a solo artist? What's special, you know, when you go swimming down there at the bottom and find this little flecks of gold or silver, what's down there? Like, why do you return to solo work in addition to the other genres and platforms that you used to have?
I'm crazy. It's terrifying. I mean, it is. There is a terrifying part of it. But I agree with Jose. We're not alone, right? There's all those characters that are up there with us, and the team behind us. I mean, I think there's something about mining that those resources where you can do all that shape-shifting. You know, you hold the story, then you have to hold the stage. The first solo show I did, I didn't write. It was written by Colombian writer Humberto Dorado. And it was an hour and 50 minutes. And it was a very heavy subject. And I felt like, you know, I had hiked Mount Kilimanjaro, like anything after that, you know. Part of it is the challenge, and part of it is the way in which, especially if it's something that I've created, that I, you know, I'm sharing that which is deepest to me, which is the story that nags at me and won't let me go to sleep because I have to write it down and get it out there. And also just knowing that as a storyteller, there are things that I'm going to be able to do afterwards that, you know, expanded my resources, you know, my abilities to such an extent.
I
just hold
them
at stage.
Let me ask you, Ruben. There's as a multidisciplinary artist, including working music and hip hop, and particularly the form of hip hop, there's a moment in freestyle where, at its best, and the entire wall, the world just falls away, and it's you in the moment, like turning the world around you. It's timeless when those kind of moments happen. And I really see a connection between the type of beauty and freedom attached to that improvisational work that's extemporaneous and what happens on stage in solo shows, because the level of focus and commitment that you muster for anywhere from an hour and a half, 2 hours, it's a very unique space as an artist. It's very rare there's an artist where for 1 to 2 hours and just in it. And the only other experience I've had that seemed similar to me was in terms of freestyle. But that, do you find a unique kind of freedom or a unique feeling associated with the intense focus of being on stage for an hour and a half to 2 hours?
It is a certain kind of high, right? I mean, it's like, you know that once that first sound cue and the lights go up, and once you get on the train, you have to ride it all the way, right? You gotta go, you can't get off, you gotta go, and things can happen, that reminds me of the way I write, and the way I live my life, I think, you know what I mean? Just taking it all in, and I'm on this train, and we keep going, and we keep going, this particular piece of mine right now, when you listen to it, it's very musical, there's a lot of rhyming in it that happened on accident. I wasn't trying to rhyme the lines. They just came out that way. And so So in performing it, it feels that way, because, and then my director, Ginan, it came up with some really brilliant transitions, like physical transitions, and the show never feels like it stops. It always feels like one thing molds into another and molds into another, and I think that's the way freestyle works as well. Freestyle, and I write in a freestyle kind of way. I don't stop. I tend not to edit. Yeah. I just allow it, everything to just kind of get on whole edit. You know, it's how that doesn't work, or that's worked, or whatever. But I don't know if that answers your question, but there is a high in free flowing. Because you're like, oh, what is this guy's app? No, what is it?
Well, let me ask you this. I'm just going to ask this of all of you, and you'll have a moment to prepare if you want. Name one or two solo shows that you saw that really had a tremendous impact on you. And you can say why.
I saw Eric Bogosian way back in the day, banging nails into the floor with my forehead, or into concrete with my forehead, something like that. And I just watched him, and I was just so amazed by just how easy he was, you know what I mean? And the characters and what he talked about and what these characters said. And I remember leaving that and going, wow, man, that dude was cool, you know? And I hadn't known who he was, and I was dating this woman, and she bought some tickets, and she said, hey, let's go check out this guy. So we're supposed to. And so that's one person. And you know, I love, like, George Carlin's stand-up. You know, I just think he's brilliant, you know what I mean? I think he's just awesome. Just the stuff that he talks about and the way he finds the little places where people go, you're right, I know it's fucked up, but it's right. You know what I mean? And I think he's brilliant. So I think, you know, people like him and, you know, and Richard Pryor, you know what I mean? Great storyteller, you know, people like that. And so I think it's the stand-up comedians that I think are even more.
Right.
They're just more out there, yeah, because they don't laugh, and then you're done. You know, and I'm too scared to try that. Mm-hmm. Like, I sometimes, like, oh, yeah, I got a lot of material, man, but it's crazy, man. At least the other ones you can see, you know. But I'm sure they have their acts, too, but.
That's interesting. Yeah, especially comedians, they connect with comedians and storytellers. Right, those are the best storytellers.
Yes. Yeah.
Got a couple of one or two solo shows that you saw that really had a profound impact on you. Why?
Yeah, I think Lily Tomlin definitely had a really strong impact on me. Because first of all, she's a woman, and she's also lesbian. And I was I didn't know that she was lesbian when I saw her until like later when I asked her out. I was kidding. She said yes. College when she came, and I got an opportunity to see her live with the Universal, I'm really bad with like names and titles, but it's a Universal Life, Universal something, right?
Yeah.
Okay. And I hear it out there. And I just think like, wow, like, to see her be able to be out there on stage by herself, in front of a lot of my colleagues and people that I respected, that majority of them were males, and I was like, oh wow, this is, not only is it like brave, like she's talking to herself on stage, like what is this? I was like 18, but definitely just her, just what she's gone, I was like a little baby. I mean, when I would see her on, you know, on in film, and I loved her, and I didn't know why, you know? And then, and then of course John Leguizamo too. When I saw Freak, that completely changed my life, because I was going through I was around that time at 18 and 19, and I was like starting in theater, and I was, you know, classic work and everything, and when I saw that, I was like, wait a minute, he's Colombian. He's talking about his crazy ass family on stage. You know?
Is that why you dance in your show?
No, that's just like the Latin thing, I think. All right, I'm not playing the stereotype. It's just because I don't know what else to do but dance and just move around.
I saw Ira Glass dancing recently. I said, Ira, I'm going to do that too.
Well,
in a show.
Yeah. Yeah, so I don't know. I just, the dancing came later in my development of the show. It was just mainly words and some movement and stuff. But I also stand-up comedians as well. There are so many stand-up comedians, but I definitely, like, throwing myself out there on stage is like, dang, that is probably like, you know, it's definitely like the hardest thing ever, right? So the solo work is as well the hardest thing ever. But anyways, yeah, those are a few. And I love Luis Alfaro too, because he's a mentor of mine as well. And I just love the images that he presents through his words and his body. And so.
So by the way, that for Jerry, he asked, you know, I've been on panels with him before, and he asked such brilliant questions right off the cuff, right? So let's just give him some kudos there, right, Jerry? Because he's always like, you know, he'll go in a very pedestrian way. He's like, you know, can you deconstruct your show and tell us about the ghosts that influence your work? Performance artists, you know, I've always been a big fan of stand-up comics, a big fan of Freddie Prinze early on, you know, just love them, bringing the Latino, the Chicano for me, I have a very pan-Latin perspective in performance art. Guillermo Gomez Peña, Rodessa Jones, whose works really influenced Karen Finney, I mentioned, Holly Hughes, Tim Miller, you know, these are performance artists whose work I've gotten a chance to see live, and you know, very influential in terms, again, of how the personal story can be used, you know, and offer a larger political context, right? How the personal can move it into the universal, and for us to be able to, you know, especially performance art in general, when we look at what's happened in the last 20, 30 years, it's been a great platform, and I saw Freak, and I love it, you know, I saw it up in New York, and I loved Mambo Mouth early on as well, but it gave a platform a lot of times to artists of color, you know, and you know, David Wozniak, one of the first artists, performance artists who railed out against the Reagan administration. He died of AIDS. So a lot of artists, you know, gay, black, gay, right? So Latino, brown, Asian, right? American Indian. You know, I love the work of James Luna, if you've ever got a chance to see him. Really brilliant people that have used that, the performance art platform, to really bring other stories to the stage. You know, because if we look at, you know, the most beautiful thing about this entire festival right now is that here we have, it's historic, right? I was hanging outside and I was talking to Kita from NIFA, and I was thinking, when was the last time I was at a National Latino Theater Festival? And we were thinking it was sometime 15 years ago. I remember, but I couldn't remember what was happening, because, you know, generally, across the stages of these United States, you know, our brown bodies, our Asian bodies, our black bodies, you know, our gay and brown and black bodies, our native bodies, we're not seen. Our stories are not seen across the stages of these United States. And here we are in 2014, and I find that very problematic still, right? So I think, performance art can be a really great platform for other voices to be heard.
I'm gonna say Adelina Anthony, who I think is amazing. I remember I took a group of teachers to see Adelina Anthony, the tortilla show. I think Adelina's so brilliant, because going back to your community question about community, because Adelina is there, right? She, like, her culture is there, forefront, right? The queerness is there, her culture is there, everything. But it's also freaking good, right? And the point is that it's freaking good. It's really good. And I remember after the teacher saying, man, I wish I was Latino so I could understand the jokes better, you know? And I'm like, I get it, but it's so good. Like, you make other people want to kind of wish they knew more of your world. And I think that solo work really could do that, you know? Because it's a more direct conversation with the audience in a way than you can do as an actor, right? So kind of making people want to wish they were part of your world, because you write about your world, right? You write about your world, and then people want to kind of be in it because you make it that way. You make them want to be in it, right? So Adelina Anthony for sure. My other one is Tim Crouch. If anybody knows who Tim Crouch is from England, I think he's amazing. I think when I saw the artist and the oak tree, and he's from England, and this guy, and he messes more with the audience, right? Which is something I would like to explore, like, when I see one of his shows, I feel like there's danger, you know, like there's a little more danger in his shows, like, and especially if you've seen the artist, like, oh my goodness, that shit's a trip, right? But I know in the second piece, my second piece is called Los Vampiros del Norte, and then I remember I was thinking of Tim Cross because that sense of like, can you make the audience feel, I don't want to say uncomfortable, but just like there's a little danger in the air, you know, and I'm attracted to that, you know, for some reason, but I would say those two.
Interesting you say danger, because that's exactly, everything changed for me when I saw Roger Wintersmith and his Huey P. Newton story. This was in the 90s, he was in Baltimore doing the show, I was doing a show there, and the way in which he embodies history, and just when everyone in the audience thinks, oh, I know what this is, he turns around and goes, no, you don't. And he allows for a complicated view, which I really appreciated his work. I mean, besides being a master storyteller and an incredible mover, it's not like you can pick it. And I love that. I love no easy answers from his work, you know. But incredibly bold and passionate and important stories that need to be heard, need to be told. And anybody know Don Saito's work here?
Yes.
Okay.
Yay!
Amazing actor, performer, Buto performer based in New York. And her physical work had a huge impact on me. As you asked the question, I was like, oh wow, yeah, I love mixing, you know, Little Don and Roger. I also loved John Leguizamo and Spalding Gray was really important.
At a desk?
Yeah, just sitting at a desk, you know. Liana Savant Nichols, when I saw her show, you know, she had broken her knee, you know, broken her knee, and she did her solo show sitting in a chair. So those are all. And Vicky Price, I love her solo work in the Phantom of
Let me ask you this, where has solo theater not gone, or not gone as strongly as you'd like to see it go in the future? You know, what directions would you like to see solo shows continue developing? Not necessarily for a specific show, but broadly in terms of aesthetics, the type of support available to stage these shows. What do you see the future of solo theater being, and what would you like it to be? Personal.
Oh, me? Yeah. Oh, boy. Oh, my God. Support? Sounds great. I mean, it's interesting because I do have a playwriting initiative that I oversee in Glassell Park, a school in Glassell Park, a school of history and dramatic art. And, you know, the point is not to have playwrights necessarily. It's more, you know, you can have an idea and have it made manifest. But on occasion, there's a real artist that comes out of this program and been doing it for 9 years with the same English teacher. Started off in a school in Highland Park, and when he moved and helped found that school, the program went with him. And I there's some kids who graduated from that program and who are in colleges and who don't want to give up their. They want to continue to be theater artists. They haven't found the right place or the right way of bringing together their ideas. I notice a lot of the young people that we're working with are really interested in the interdisciplinary thing of how they can take a visual idea they have and a movement idea they have and some text and put it together. And there aren't a lot of places where they can put that together. And I'm actually trying to create a kind of lab here for that, for people like, I'm thinking of a couple of particular people who come from this program. So, I mean, physical space and support and artists of different backgrounds being able to support the solo artist's vision of being able to put this stuff together. It's not easy to find that. Things are so compartmentalized. And it's expensive. You know, if without the help of the right kind of grant, you just can't get those other collaborators to help lift the project out of, you know, I mean, which is great, and Spalding great, could sit behind the desk and tell a great story, but I feel like there's a whole other level that could be explored in terms of transdisciplinary communication, collaboration that I'd love to see happen.
What would you like to see in terms of future of solo theater? Where do you think solo theater in America is going? You don't even really want to just limit it to our shores, but where do you see solo theater here and around the world going in terms of what's interesting to you? What's coming down the road or that you're connected with that you think, you know, might sustain your artistic cultural interest next year?
I mean, I don't know. I mean, I don't think I'm well versed enough to really answer that, but all I can say is I agree with you about the spaces, you know. I do think we need more spaces to explore solo work, you know. For everyone I know, Karen, when we were with Luis, I know we slowly saw the numbers dwindle down, right? The people who started the class and the people who finished. But that's okay, right? That's natural. So then you have to have another one, right? Because then, you know, the next one, maybe one or two, and then the next one or two, if there's only one, you know. So I agree with that, but I would always just say about solo work is what intrigues me, and I'm going to go back to Tim Crouch, is I do feel like that solo artists are trying to find different ways to interact with the audience. I do feel that. One of Tim Crouch's shows is in a museum. It's set in a museum, so you go to a physical museum, and then you watch the art pieces, and he starts his show. Right? It's very interesting. It was very interesting to me. So I feel kind of that solo artists are trying to find different ways to involve the audience in an experience, right? Versus I'm here doing characters and watch me. I feel like solo artists are trying to push that in a different way. And I'm curious about that too.
Theater is just basically for older white people, right? I mean, that's what I read earlier today before I was prepping for the show.
Where did you read that?
Fox News.
What Stewart called it, Bullshit Nation? Yeah,
right.
Bullshit Mountain?
But there are real structural, you know, realities that theater companies are up against, be they large institutions, medium or small. And one of the real continuing problems of theater that, and you see this as an artist, you go around, is that there's, we rarely create theater that appeals to young people. Rarely create theater. I'm not talking about children's theater. I'm talking about the, you know, theater for adults that isn't, you know, written for an older group of folks, kind of almost exclusively, it seems. There's like a default posture that makes it difficult for work that resonates with young people to be brought into theaters. Am I completely full of crap, or how do we as working theater artists do what we can do to contribute to have this all process?
This is what I mean. I love the default posture. I'm going to remember that. So a couple of things. I want to answer that, but also, so when what you were saying, Marissa, but so when Eric Bogosian says, I'm not a performance artist, right? Because he was actually a playwright. But the economics, because of economics not being able to put together his work in New York, he decided to... his own characters, right? It was an economics thing. I used to work with an improv theater group in New Orleans, and you know, we were very successful, but only few are willing to make the long distance run, right? When I did my comedy juggling show, I also used to do a duo comedy juggling show throughout Europe. But sometimes economics brings us to the point, you know, sometimes I come from a pen or a poet and I begin writing, right? I begin writing, I have an idea, that the story that wants to come out. Right, so we have to figure out the strategies, and really out of economics, I migrated much more towards doing the solo performance work. Now, I also work with a lot of youth, and I think that's the best audience, because if I'm not kicking it for a young people's crowd, like, and I was also writing about the migration of hip-hop and theater, when it was all happening, you know, in the mid-90s, and I'm very familiar with the work of Universes, Hip Hop Theater Junction, seeing poets like Sarah Jones, when Hip Hop Theater into full-fledged shows. They're the audience that needs to tell you what's up, right? I was just at CalArts, and I had a great time because I would begin each class with an excerpt from the Aliens piece just to be able to deal with what we were going to explore that evening, that particular workshop. And if young people can't, you know, if the work doesn't turn them on for me, they're like the best audiences I know. If it doesn't turn them on, then something's not right. I think that what's happening is that we also have a Eurocentric power structure with a paradigm within the United States in terms of what controls theater that has created and established venues where theater has become really taken hostage by that Eurocentric power structure and the arts as well. So therefore, you know, we have had to create our own spaces and we're still dealing with that in general. You know, I mean, so I think that the future can be a lot brighter if we make sure that, you know, generations are continuously being cultivated. And you gotta look at the forms. What are the forms that, you know, I'm a hybrid genre, you know, form. The work is formed by visual arts, spoken word, films, personal stories, documentary work, and, you know, soundscapes and all these. But at the end, it's a real, you know, live personal story and ritual. I think it's really important. But the economics are tough, so, you know, only with that grant from the National Performance Network was I able, when that happened, that was the first time I was able to hire, you know, like folks who had volunteered for me before or even, you know, put the show on my credit card, right? And I noticed that nervously, I like scratched my ear because I remember that. I was like, putting the show on my credit card. But when we got the funding, you know, then you could help build and create something, you know, much more powerful. If young audiences, for me, if they don't get it, then it's like, then I'm not doing something well.
I agree. Yeah, when young people don't get it, it's like, what the fuck am I doing? you design work exclusively for opera generations. Yeah, and you're solo with this.
What the hell is that?
I don't know. the relevance. I say, you know, we're not like writing for audiences generally. I don't know, I'll describe anyone's process, but you know, you write for the reasons you write for. But in terms of presenting your work and your work connecting with audiences, is it a consideration for you to try to cultivate particular audience segments, or do you find that people come out right here? I'm probably the youngest person on the panel. Is any of this, am I just talking to my ass here? I mean, I think there's a problem with getting young people. We're not often making, no matter what we want to admit to ourselves, we're often not making theater that is appealing to young people. And I think generally, as artists, we all need to be better at it or working towards it. Generally, there are always exceptions. What do you think?
Well, I mean, I think like generally, like when it's like solo work, like, and writing and processing that, and like, what's the gem here? What am I trying to say? What's gonna connect with people? Generally, it's very universal, like how we were talking about. Like, it is universal, right? There's something there. So I think like discovering what the story is, obviously it's like, you know, what that's gonna be what's gonna, you know, drive people through, but also just, I think like, really working with different types of forms in different ways and interesting ways, like exploring them, like turning them inside out, like music, movement, like space, you know, and really just like flipping it upside down, you know, and just like, hey, what are we gonna do with this big ass room, you know? And just, you know, through solo work, you know, through the collaboration of all the different, you know, artists I'm working with or that we work with, you know, we the funding, you know, right? It's like, it's I think exploring things in different ways is really interesting to me because I could be like, oh, this is a plastic bottle. And so how I can make this, you know, something else, and then also talk about the politics of having plastic water bottles. And I think that to me is really interesting because I think it's like solo work is so important because of the politics we can really bring to the tables and but not in like, we're going to be talking about this, you know? So then I think young people will be like more intrigued by how we present it and how we explore it in ways that perhaps have been done before, but they have never seen, or because it's through your, through the solo performer, and each, every one of us is unique. So I think in that way, I'm exploring music, you know, I love that you're writing an opera, because like this speaks to me, because I'm exploring music in so many different ways, and I'm coming out with like all kinds of, I'm like, wow, you know, when I was a kid, that's what I wanted to do, but I was so like, no, this is not what I'm gonna do, no, my voice is not, oh, okay. So then I'll do this, or I'm gonna be a psychologist, or this and that. So, and then finally, it actually comes out. It comes out somehow. This dream, this seed inside is somehow manifesting out, somehow. So I don't know. That's part of like how to reach out to young people and how it's important, or how to tell stories in a way that you are unique and turning yourself inside out. And I'm being scared.
They said that you
they should put me on there.
I think that
turn them upside down.
Exactly. I think we do need young Bill O'Reilly.
Yeah.
Did you say we need a young Bill O'Reilly? Is that
yeah.
What you just said?
Young Bill O'Reilly. Let me ask you, Ruben, do you think that there is any, do you think that the issues facing theaters are something that there's a space for you to address it or think about or include it in any way in your work as a theater artist? Or does your work as an artist, you just kind of, like me, operate in a little vacuum where we ignore reality around us?
Yeah. I don't know what that question means. No, I'm being honest, I'm so stupid.
do you think that the pressures of our presenters,
oh,
can they translate into your work at all?
No. Because I don't have to present it. I just write, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
You write because you have to, because the story has to get out. And
do you try to build your work to appeal to a particular audience? Who are you trying to speak to?
No, I don't, because I usually, I'm so much of a solo artist in the way that I call up university like clubs and go, hey, you guys have like a spot like for Cinco de Mayo? Or whatever, right? And that's how I kind of do things. I don't have a booking agent. I don't have personal connections to theaters, and so I have to create a connection with a school or something to say, can you bring me in? And so I don't have to appeal to anybody in that way. I just have to say what I need to say and what I'm seeing in the world and what's affecting me and what's coming through me. And going back to the young adults, I'm blessed that this show really connects to young people. You know, and I've done it for a lot of, like...
How does the show connect to young people? Probably always has.
Because the lead character is a senior in high school who's dealing with drugs, who's dealing with his, with violence, who's dealing with the economic downturn and how it affects him and his life. And he's dealing with issues that I think most young people are dealing with right now.
Why did you write a high school student? I'm sorry.
Why
did you choose to write a
high school student? Because I was, like a lot of actors, we're substitute teachers, you know, when we're auditioning, whatever. And I was asked to take over what they call an opportunity room, you know, which is the students at the sweat hogs. They were the sweat hogs, and I was Gabe Cotter, right? And that's an old reference. Yeah. So it's a good reference. So I had my sweat hogs, you know, and you know, I was supposed to have, and I had them for 10 weeks, and I was supposed to have 8 students, and I ended up having like 17 students, and pretty much from different bodies. So they were all from different gangs, you know, they were in a different way. And there was one particular student that I was kind of mentoring, I was trying to, right? And he was very, very intelligent. But you know, at the end of the day, after the 10 weeks, I find out that you know he'd been doing speed and he'd been just lying to me, and I was going, you know, bending over backwards for him. And so the show kind of took off. The writing really took off from remembering my conversations with Daniel. And
so you actually talk to young people in the world?
No, I don't talk to them. I mean, I had him in a class, you know. I mean, I tried to talk to them.
Right. I used to go to the zoo.
Yeah,
exactly.
But you know what? It's important, I excuse me, for a writer, I think, is to talk less and listen more. You know what I mean? And I think when you listen more and you put yourself in a vulnerable place emotionally, and I think the world around you and what's happening will come through you and allow you to write for them, and be the reporter for them, putting your pulse on where, for me, it's like I like to find where the pain is and where people are being challenged so we can find a different way to look at what they're going through. And I think that's sort of what this piece is about, you know, it's about perspective, you know, and just switching it a little bit. And so I'm trying to, with the children, you know, with the young kids that come and watch that, it's, they know when you're bullshitting, you know, they know when you're lying, and so doing it for the 10 a.m. show, you know, for magnet students who are all smart and just really respectful and just watching. Mm-hmm. You know, it's interesting, but one young kid, he was the only one who spoke up, and he said, that was real to me, you know, he goes, I know all these people. That was my uncle, and that was this person in there, and the powerful thing about solo shows, especially when you're doing different characters, they could just be fascinated by what you're doing and watching you sweat. And they're fascinated by that. Like, wow, how does somebody remember all that? You know, and or whatever. How do they do that? How do they physically become an old lady and all of a sudden you're an 18-year-old kid, you know, whatever. And so that's the power of solo shows, you know what I mean? Because they're like, you're up there by yourself. And a young kid, well, they feel like they're by themselves. They think they're living in the world by themselves and they gotta make all these big decisions. And when you can connect to that and something that's real to them, that's when you got them.
I was just gonna say that I know it's interesting because I know the Sueños Frost Flake is gonna get published next year, and actually a young theater for young audiences book. But I never ever even considered that it was a piece for young audiences. I mean, that was completely not in my brain at all, right? But someone thinks it is, right? So that's interesting. Like, do you write for that audience? I mean, I can't do that. I think. It takes a lot of skill to do that, right? Like, I'm not there yet. Like, I just wrote what I had to write, what had to come out, and it happened to be in that world. That's great. So, but I do feel though that you're responsible at least for young people at least to at least be connected to the world still, to kind of as much as you can, like to know their metaphors and their you know what I'm saying? Like, I have an example because I taught fourth grade last year, and I would always talk about Harry Potter, right? They have no idea who Harry Potter was. They didn't know who it was, right? And it was shocking to me, but then I'm like, okay, so I have to know who Lemony Snicket is, right? So like you know what I'm saying? Like, at least that response, and it made me think, like, that responsibility to, yeah, at least keep up with the world in that sense, not necessarily write to them, but at least keep up with the world that's going on in that way, you know, if that makes sense.
But I also feel like I've been a little surprised by some of the responses to the work that I've done that young people have responded to really positively. Like, I think we have to be careful about making assumptions.
Absolutely.
And I remember something at the Latino Theater, LA Latino Theater Alliance meeting in July. There was a young woman who works in TYA and said, you know, they don't want to be talked down to. You know, they don't want to be, I mean, it's even in the summertime, I work with high school students, 10th, 11th, and 12th graders, and there's this like really slow exercise I do, and I always worry because they want to do the fast games and improvs and stuff like that. And every time I do that slow one, they're like, gee, thanks, we wanted to slow down. We wanted to, and so I try and keep that in mind as well, you know, that I don't want to make assumptions, I want to know the references, and I want to keep the work vital, but in some ways, if I'm working from a passionate place, if I'm working from an honest, truthful place, they're gonna know that, they're gonna feel that.
Connect them as individuals and everything else follows.
There we go.
I know we are, okay with time?
Yeah, we have like 20 more minutes.
Okay, great. Are we doing Q&A?
Yeah.
Okay, I think I'm gonna ask one more question. We're gonna jump right into the audience Q&A. You are required, Ruben, to fight one person, have sex with the other, and kill the other. Harry Potter, Obama, Romney. Quick.
Say it again.
Harry Potter, Romney,
no, sex.
Obama.
Sex,
fight, kill. Which one?
Sex, I had to say my wife. what's the other one?
Kill.
Kill my wife. Not kidding, I'm totally kidding, I love it. No, kill that a bug.
Harry Potter, everyone knows that you've got that one. Harry Potter's the answer, last one.
And the other one?
Fight.
Fight the power!
Okay, that's good enough. I really, I want to thank you all, the panel members, for this really enlightening conversation, in spite of my diatribe just now, in spite of that digression, but really an enlightening panel. And I'd like to open up the discussion, or for comments or questions, rather, for the panelists from the audience.
A process question for those of you who have worked with directors or generally worked with a director. Can you talk a little bit about how that process is for you? For example, do you meet and talk and then go away and rehearse and work and then come and show and critique? Or is the director there all the time? Can you just talk about that collaboration, if it has existed for you?
I can just speak because my director's right there. I'll usually write whatever I wrote, and then I'll hand it to him, and or he'll look at it, and he doesn't want to read it because he has too many other things to do. So he goes, read it to me. So we'll sit there, and I'll read him this diatribe, and he'll look at it, and Ginan's very good at editing, so he'll just go, all right. But then we'll just kind of work with the script, and he'll have these questions, you know, through line questions and such and such. And then from there, we'll, he knows me for a long time, so he knows, like, I need to physically get up and start, you know, we'll start playing with it like that. And then as we, and we'll work on it, and then for me, as I'm also still in the writing process, I'll say, all right, you know what, let me, give me a couple of days to go back and kind of, I see something now that I didn't see before. He usually brings light to something and makes my train of thought go, oh, I didn't see that. Yeah, then go and clean that up, and then we'll come back. So it's kind of like that back and forth for me.
Yeah, I guess I've worked with different directors, and sometimes I feel like I'm in a box or I'm like strapped in. So it's really important, like this relationship. I'm exploring what it means to be maybe perhaps through my movement, direct myself. It's been a very spiritual journey for myself working on my work, and I'm also exploring what it means to work with different directors. So.
So I don't work with directors per se. I work with a group of eyes of collaborators that, like, again, and it all depends on really so much. We got a good support for the funding for Aliens that we were able to do shows, like basically like performance reading of it in front of the Latino community, African American community, the white community in New Orleans. And hear feedback, and just hear what people are waiting, and those really helped me. And some memorized, even when I did it in D.C., some memorized, and some performed, and just dealing with a topic where we brought day laborers, and I do one of the day laborer stories in New Orleans. I perform one of their stories because it's based on film interviews. Bringing them into the theater, bringing what they need to hear, bringing the African American community to see. So, and John Grimsley, who's my lighting designer, he'll say, Jose, you know, and he's very democratic, and we have this great process, and just hear feedback and get to a particular place so that the honesty and the inhabited personas, the characters are there in their most raw form early on, and maybe polished a little bit later, but also engaging with the audience's view, you know, like the piece was also presented to young people, because I also teach Latino Youth Theater Project in New Orleans and bring Latinos and African Americans together, and I'll perform for them, and I hear what they have to say. And it's really important, so a lot more of other eyes, other than just working with a director. We're doing a new project called the Aliens Taco Truck Theater Project, where I'm working directly with a director, Deepanka Mukherjee, because of our synergy and our interest. And it's a collaboration project. And Raquel Almazan, a very well-known playwright in New York and a fierce performance artist herself that I met in Miami, will be performing, you know, and we'll be working with the director. But we're also looking to engage three different dreamers in each city to have them tell their own stories and how to we bring their stories. Because I've interviewed many dreamers as well, and you know, looking to see how to use the voices of the community really in a very Augusto Boal kind of way for them to be able to be protagonists for their own stories.
Can I say something about that? For both shows, I've worked with Alejandra Cisneros. God bless her, she's directed both times. And it, for my case, it was interesting because I had, it was they were both commissions, so I had a deadline. By the way, there's nothing better for writing than to have a deadline, right? Right. But both times, it was very similar. She would not let me rehearse until the script. She felt the script. She became the dramaturg in both cases, actually. She would not let me rehearse until we thought the script was ready. And then that first show, I mean, it was down to 10 days before I got on my feet. So I was terrified. But now that I think back on it, it was fantastic because the script was ready. You know what I'm saying? Like, so that was the process for me, just the writing. The writing is the most important, right? The writing. If the writing is ready, is there, then you can take it from there.
Thank you.
Yes. Hi, I'm Isanga, and I guess I would call myself like a three-year-old sola performer. So I was wondering what types of grants you all would recommend or programs that commission you that you found beneficial, because it's very expensive to produce. Obviously, you all understand your own work. So this is for anyone.
I'd like to know that answer too.
Yeah.
I think I'll just very briefly say that I'm always more absolutely shocked than anything else when someone writes a check to support something I'm doing. I'm always like floored, like, oh my God, I can't believe these suckers went for it again. I mean that just from the sense of the money's so rare and kind of hard to find, and it's just so weird that I don't put much energy or emphasis on it because it would completely discourage me from doing that work. So I just kind of do the work, and you know, you meet the folks you meet, and if the work resonates, and which I know is exactly not what you're asking for. You're asking something very specific. But
she wants to know who's giving you the checks. That's
yeah,
what
I mean, Keenan and I are the recipients of a large grant for just over $16,000 from the Irvine Foundation. It's an institutional grant for these projects working on paper. But that was just luck. I mean, in all honesty, it had nothing to do with me. It was a great grant writing apparatus. Gene and those folks at the taper. And I wouldn't have even known that grant existed if the taper hadn't said, hey, I want to work with you on this. So I kind of think that I'm just crazy about money and weird shit in my life, and I don't like to think about it. So it's easier for me to just focus on the work, and on occasion get lucky and connect with an organization or an individual institution that might support it. At least that has been what my process has been.
So then what would that place be? You guys can name anything, I mean, in terms of, like, if it is grants or if it is a theater company that you found you had a really great relationship with that supported the work, supported solo performers, what, like, who is that? And I'm asking because I'm currently transitioning here, like, I'm moving to LA soon, and I don't know anyone. So this is, like, such a great introduction, right, to build relationships, and I'm very excited to, like, meet people, so.
I just go after the people that interest me, right? So I go see your show, I'm like, wow, that's awesome. I'll just go and talk to that person. But if maybe it's a 2-minute conversation, nothing goes further than that. But it's, I'm not in any way strategic about it. I probably should be, but it's just what resonates with me, you know? Because they go, yeah, you lose a lot.
So, Sandra, if I could offer some support just to that. I feel very fortunate. And again, you know, nothing happens on one's own. Above all, make the work. Make the work, write the work, do the work. Just that's, you know, it's a long, you know, I used to be a long distance runner, and one of my mentors, African American, the arts, it's a long distance run, so you've got to make the work. Now, I will say that I feel extremely fortunate. Early on, when I was telling the story, I think to Kida, there with the 1990, you know, I'm performing in the streets, I'm, you know, I'm doing stuff in New Orleans, and I'm working with Jumba Productions, who's a national performance network company, and I'm doing stuff with the CAC, things are starting to get seen. I used to perform at bars and coffee shops, right, like many of us did in those days, and almost like the way stand-up comics did in many ways. I got very fortunate the National Performance Network invited me back in 94 to exhibit, to present the first piece that I toured nationally and international called We Are Patrons with Dark Faces, and I was showcased at this National Performance Network conference in New Orleans, and things happened. Guillermo Gomez-Pena happened to be there, John O'Neill happened to help support the work as well, and you know, I started making connections. Now I'm also a renegade scholar, so I've always been writing about work, and I also have made connections with many scholars. I've, you know, there are networks, but the National Performance Network, for example, Highways is an NPN site here in Santa Monica. LACE is one as well, right? Other organizations, and look for funding. You know, TCG has individual funding grants, and I can give you some more specifics, but the NPN actually cultivated a lot of performance art voices, some of which I've mentioned before here. Dan Kwan, Tim Miller, Lodessa Jones, you know, Holly Hughes, even Philip Glass earlier.
Yeah.
Red Cats, both the Red Cat Studio and Now Festival, that's all local artists. Bootleg Theater has been a really great supporter of a lot of interesting stuff. The Center for Cultural Innovation has both grants and really great workshops for artists, just to name a few off the top of my head.
Can I comment on this, David, or just?
Yeah, your actor said it. I shouldn't allow you to speak.
No.
I want to say part of it is the resources is the question. How to find the resources to do your work. And sometimes I think solo performances actually happen in the context of a much bigger company or community. And the reason why Ruben has been able to develop his work is because he is a member of the Teatro Campesino. As an artist who has given over 20 years, when he said, I would like to do this piece, all of us in the company said, absolutely, we're going to work and support you in your personal vision to have this become real. In your case, you're part of the theater company. Just because you're going solo, it's your relationships and your networks are important, because you have a bunch of supporters that will help mobilize the resources to make your solo work happen. It's not just about the grant, it's about the resources. And ultimately, it's going to come down to the power of our relationships. And so that is also the, we have to remember solo work happens not just as individuals, but there's a network of supporters who are going to be right behind you and pushing you in. Somebody said, you know, theater is never a collective enterprise, individual enterprise. And that is true as well.
It's always collective. Always collective.
I have to say, like, as a woman, I think it's just, I feel connected to anyone who's doing solo work that's a woman. Just, I would say if I could offer anything, it's just see your vision and just stick to it and be as detailed as possible and it will come. I know that sounds like that's not the one to ask you want, but I used to ask that question, so I just want to say that everything that everyone's saying, plus just really have that vision and it will happen.
Intention, you gotta put it out there.
But there are grants. So, you know, look at TCG individual grants. Some of us feel, I feel very fortunate because there's been a collective tribe of people that have helped to support the work that I've been doing. I mean, I met Jorge back in 1995 when Eloisa de Leon, who was at the Centro Cultural de la Raza, had seen me in 94 at the NPN and brought me to Centro and UCSD, and I met all these amazing people. You know, I met the Theater Arts, the Board of Arts Workshop people, I met Richard Liu, I met, that whole San Diego collective. And again, you know, that we helped to create tribes of network and support. And like here, like we're doing here, you know, we have a beautiful tribe of people that we're getting to meet each other, and the resources will, you know, you have to look and be your own pioneer in that way.
So I'm not your tribe.
Well, I have to say, remember the reason we're here is because it's all about networking. And we're not going to meet here in a vacuum, you know, Tiffany and I and some fellow, another scholar that's coming in throughout the course of the event. We're documenting it. We have websites. We have cafe onda. We don't have to, you just pointed out, we do not have an anthology of Latina, Latino solo work.
We don't.
And
we
she
don't.
Has,
we need.
Among the other things, she had nothing else to do. In her madness, but it's true. We need an anthology.
Yeah.
So it's about getting on, you know, you're going to be here in LA, the Latino Theater Alliance, that you know, people here are very involved in. That's why we're together since, you know, forever.
It's so important. We have O Solo Como and works available in that question. But as I was listening to people talk, I thought we really need to have an anthology of Latino solo performance as an editor and a dramaturg. I've published Adelina Anthony's work and A Slip of the Tongue by Latino Breath of Fire, other playwrights. But you know, I think it's really, Jorge always says, all the artists need to have a scholar who is like a designated keeper of their work, and I think we need to reach out and have people that will usher the work into print.
I'm very grateful. Yeah, that's a really brilliant. We need to do that. We need to do that. Because, like for example, in that big, the Joe with Joe Bonney, when Joe, I just missed it. When Joe, I just got to New York, and Joe Bonney had heard my work, and Leguizamo was in there, and a number of other people. And I just missed, she was like, oh, Jose, I just heard about the work, and I just missed that big fat dick.
The Ransom Rave,
yeah. The Solo Rave or something like that.
Yeah.
Yeah, I just missed that one. But I have to tell you, this is 25 years of performance poems that just got published, and many of them are selected poems, performance poems from 7 different monologues. But a solo, an anthology of solo work, you know, across the Latino spectrum is certainly needed.
That's a good idea now that you're semi-retired, Dr. Jorge. That's a great idea.
I know we had a couple of the questions. I'm trying to get to them, and we're just going to try to get a single response so we can get to both questions. The old ladies in the front here. Yes, ma'am?
Yeah. So kind of piggybacking off of this comment, I am really interested in how each of you have found artistic and creative home, being a solo artist, or what that has meant and how that's transformed over the course of your career.
Only one can answer.
I'll start.
There you go.
I definitely agree with Kinan, absolutely. If it wasn't for East LA Rep, I mean, that's the creative space where I found this voice. We were a theater company, we turned into a creative space to bring artists and community together. Luis Alfaro became a friend, he offered a master class for us, and there you go. I also met Alejandro through East LA Rep, right? The director, so absolutely, yeah. Find a community, find someone that you connect with, like, I feel good here, I like these people here, and you start, and then definitely.
Yeah, and I think because I went to teatro with my first solo show. I came to teatro and I had the show. But what I learned from having support from a theater is that it's aesthetically appealing now because you have the support of lighting people, of designers, and people that can, and it makes you a better actor and it makes the show just a little bit just fuller. So
my home in New Orleans has been the Ashe Cultural Arts Center, the African American Community Center, since 2004, where they helped to commission this particular piece and others. It was previously the Contemporary Arts Center, but then the Contemporary Arts Center somehow went in a different direction. And you know, you got to find a home, and they were willing to let me. Also, the Ashe Carol Babel opened up her home, her center, her casa. She has a very mi casa es tu casa perspective, because post Katrina, with so much New Orleans Latino immigrants that came in and the growing Latino population, we don't have a cultural center. So that the Ashe Cultural Center has become really important for that Latino community. And they're doing a lot around the Black and the Brown Alliance, and I was the first Latino artist to really begin working with them as far back as 2004, and that's been my home.
Sacrifice them.
go for the vision. And probably the first, the second solo piece I did, which was the first time I was working behind the camera. I knew nothing about the camera, and I was very hesitant to do it, and kind of was pushed a little bit by my loved ones to just ask a DP if he would partner up with me. And I was like, but I have nothing to offer him. I was like sweating when I went to talk to this guy. And I told him the idea of the project, and he went, oh, great, sure. And I went, really? Like, I'm just gonna give you Cuban food. And that's enough? And he's like, yeah, I love shooting. And the idea sounds great. And so don't be afraid to ask. Ask for what you want. Go for the vision. Go for the big idea. And you know, the worst he could have said was no, and I can go to the next person. But artists want to work. And especially, you've got a good idea, you're gonna get the collaborators you want.
Yeah, and if you're going for multimedia and all that stuff, always don't be afraid to look at students that are about to graduate from film schools and stuff like that. They just want to get a reel going. And if they can help you out in any which way, and they're great. I did my own feature film, you know, an independent feature film, and I used ex-students of mine who were now in film school, and they were seniors, and they said, yeah, I'll do it. Yeah, I'll get you a crew. And they got me a crew, and we did it. And it's and you use those they are enthusiastic and have way more energy than you do, and they will work, man. You just feed them, people. You know, you gotta give them. They want to feel it, but yeah, students are and they're great. I mean, these kids know, you know, they know how to you know work a TV, you know, like by the age of like 3 months, they're like, you know, my son grabs my phone, all of a sudden I got a new ringtone. I'm like, I always have it on vibrate, and he's got like jingle bells playing.
Exactly. Yeah.
So, it's about finding your tribe and also, you know, being realistic about what's needed, not like, you know. And then I envision for the third floating screen, if you can't tell the story in one or two general washes, you can't tell the fucking story. The lighting's not telling the story. But these are just polished accent, and yes, they're a critical and important part of what you do, but not at the beginning when you're developing and building. That you know, you don't have to worry about having a full-fledged production on your very first. And having a space, like a black box space with a couple lights and some music you choose, and you can do a little bit of video design yourself, or starting with those elements yourself, and then bring on someone more talented. But, you know, keep it small, keep it close, and let it grow organically.
Yeah, use the economics as an empowerment tool, the lack of it maybe sometimes, rather than as an oppressive tool.
Yes.
You know, I've added a lot of, you know, now I've gotten a little bit obsessed with too much media. And you know, but at the end, when I was at Cal Arts, I just do the, you know, like, boom, I just threw down excerpts of the piece in what I call the Aliens Unplugged. And at the beginning with like Bogosian and Leguizamo, I heard this brilliant show on Leguizamo with Mambo Mouth, that all, because he was doing the projections and it was really funny, that everything broke down. And he just went ahead and just did the whole piece, actually satirized the whole idea of the projections and everything. You know, just like, do it. The economics, don't let the economics, you know, be an oppressive thing. Like, let it be an empowering thing, because at the end, it's you know, whatever it is that you're telling, the imperative nature, you, your force, your movement, your text, how you work with the space, how you deal with the audience, what kind of collective ritual you're creating, that's gonna be the driving force. And then slowly the network starts to come there and come to inhabit you. I was also saying, Lisandra Nala, the National Association of Latino Arts and Culture, become a member, apply for the grants.
Yeah, and you know, Bob Dylan said three chords in the truth, right? So soul artists, we say three lights in the truth.
Yeah, there you go.
Nice.
I was just working at a bar.
And if you don't have three lights, you get a flashlight. Yeah. Different angles, right? Different angles.
All right, Richard Lopez de Vega said two boards and a passion, he said in Spanish. Two boards and a passion for you. Good feeling. Not even a light.
Heck, we do it in the daytime.
Yeah. I think we're all incredibly fortunate to have this really amazing group of artists here today to share their experiences with us all. And I'm very happy they came and they shared so generously and freely and put up with me as well. So I want to thank you all for coming and thank the artists.
Yeah, great.